Blackstone Audio presents Ender's World, fresh perspectives on the science fiction classic Ender's Game, edited by Orson Scott Card. This book is read by Gabrielle de Cuir, Janis, Arthur Morey, Stefan Rudnicki, and Orson Scott Card.
Introduction, Orson Scott Card. I thought I had a pretty good story when I gave my first draft of the original novelette, Ender's Game, to my mother to type up for submission. My mother had been another set of eyes on all my plays and my handful of previous stories. So, even though I had long been a very fast and accurate typist myself, I passed her my longhand manuscript because I wanted to see how the story would work for her. This was my first serious attempt to write a sci-fi story to sell. My theater company was getting good attendance, but losing money even with no rent and no salaries to pay. You can lose money on hit plays. I needed Ender's Game to help me launch a non-theatrical writing career. As a non-fan of sci-fi, my mother would definitely let me know if I had something that would work outside the science fiction community. I was surprised at how strongly positive her reaction was. She had enjoyed my Worthing stories, but those were completely character-centered, with not a single spaceship and, for that matter, no electricity or power tools or weapons beyond a medieval level. They felt like fantasy. So Ender's Game was the first time I had asked my mother to read something that really felt like science fiction. It wasn't the space stuff that worked for her. It was the child under pressure, isolated, and yet able to build a community around him, able to keep his head and think inventively, even when problems seemed impossible to everyone else. It was the human story. It still is. Even as I adapted the story to novel length 10 years later, and then spent another decade trying to distill the story into a form that would work for film, I never got confused about the source of the story's power. Ender's Game does not work because it's sci-fi, or even a war story, nor does it work in spite of those things. Ender's Game works because it is a story of the individual within the community. The great dilemma of human life is that we are all strangers in a strange land. Genetically, we are disposed to be communitarian. Even the worst misanthrope needs human company, hungers for it. And no matter how individualistic we are, no matter how self-motivated, other people have strange and terrible powers over us. They can fill us with joy just by saying completely stupid things like, "Good job," or, "You were so cool." We are so hungry for the approval of the community that a pat on the back from someone we despise still makes us feel good. Even if we're ashamed of feeling good, we feel it. It's like our innate response to little children. We feel protective. That's why the most terrible sound when a plane is landing is not the creaking of fatigued metal. It's the sound of a baby crying at the ear pain that results from the changing air pressure of landing. And when, in a play or movie, they show a child crying abjectly, our hearts stir with sympathy, even when we know that untalented, cynical writers are manipulating us. Because the survival of the human race depends on our passing along the gene that makes empathy for children a deep, abiding attribute of humans. Yeah, that's part of the appeal of Ender's Game, too. And don't you forget it. Ender's Game works most powerfully when we see Ender as a child. But more important than Ender Wiggins' status as a child is the fact that regardless of age, he is an individual who is systematically excluded from the very community that he is required to save. When Graff and Rackham, each in his own way, work to isolate Ender Wiggin, they know what they're doing. Nothing could possibly stress this child more than breaking off his connection with other people. So why do they do it? How will this help him? Battle school is not about training soldiers. It's about training war leaders, people who can guide the soldiers, the bravest and strongest of a community's members, to risk their lives and commit terrible acts of killing in order to promote the survival and growth of the community. In the testing that determines who is fit for command, it is vital that the selected candidates have a powerful sense of the importance of the community. That translates into a deep hunger to belong, an ability to love and care for others, strong empathy, and a willingness to sacrifice for the genuine good of others. But it is just as vital that they be able to send other soldiers off to die. Weigh that in the balance for a moment. If you have war leaders who cannot bear to risk their soldiers' lives, you will lose to a determined enemy. But if you have war leaders who do not treasure and value the lives of their soldiers, you will waste them. If I were writing one of the essays in this book, I would now overwhelm you with examples of both kinds of flawed leaders from world history. Instead, I will simply say that because Ender Wiggin was so extreme in his ability to love others and identify with them, it was.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.